Good morning.
Good morning.
It's great to see you all this morning here on time, hopefully. It feels as if every other news report or Facebook post is on the whole coronavirus situation. And then Reverend Anna somehow will bring it up again. My intention in bringing it up to you today is not only to just let you know certain precautions that we're taking as a community to minimize risk, but also to get you centered on principle and spiritually so that you may stay in a place of power and peace. For we know that our sense of security does not come from the out there, but from within. We remember Jesus' words of saying, in this world we will find tribulation, but I have overcome this world. And that I have overcome this world really means that I, as the Christ, as the I am, it is through that presence that we can be still and be centered and be happy. So this is a great opportunity for us as a community to practice what we teach. So we get on by affirming, doing our affirmation of faith together. It's gonna come up. Together. There's only one presence and one power in my life and in the universe. God the good, omnipotent. We'd like to remind everybody that whatever we give power to has power over us. And I don't know you, but I'm choosing to give power to God. Have a beautiful quote from Ellen Yogacharyas from this week as she's doing the same thing in her community. She says, if thoughts of worry, fear, or frustration arise in your mind, practice taking a prayer moment of remembrance. Recall that divine grace is already at work in your life. So we choose to see the blessing. We choose to see the cure coming. We choose to see all the countries, all the global leaders in the world uniting as they tackle this disease. And for now, we might just do a few little things like during our greeting of the Christ, there's gonna be less hugging and more bowing, less physical and more reverential. But the love is the constant, and the recognition of each other's divinity will still hold. It's really refreshing to really not do something automatically, but really be present to each other's company and awareness. So let's not close our hearts, not give in to our consciousness of fear, and remember, like one of the Course in Miracles teachers, I don't really remember his name, but I remember the quote, sometimes the greatest miracles come in the ugliest packages. So this is our pledge as our community that stands in faith, that we choose not to see separation and chaos, but a world of unity and order. And this is our greatest contribution. And this is what we're saying, even Reverend Neusom, you'll see him tonight at WRAL at 6 o'clock saying how we're coming together in that consciousness and affirming together that all will be well and that all is well. And so it is, and so we let it be.
Every praise to our God.
Yes, it is. Please remain standing now and join us in singing Imagine. Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine there's no country. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for. Please take a moment and greet the people around you using space. Thank you. I believe that somewhere in the darkest night, a candle glows. I believe for everyone who goes astray, someone will come to show the way. Storm, the smallest prayer will still be heard. I believe that someone in the great somewhere hears every word. Every time I hear a newborn baby cry or touch a leaf or see the sky, then I know why I
your heart is really open. That's what happens when we let fear go and we stand on faith. Mother Teresa says that it is through faith that we open ourselves to new possibilities. So I want to welcome everybody officially to our 11 o'clock service. Not only those of you who are here, but those of you who are part of this ministry as you tune in through the internet. Thank you so much for saying yes to this space, to this energy, to this consciousness. And I do have some announcements this morning, starting off by saying thank you to those volunteers who were here to be a welcoming presence during Super Tuesday. Our church was a polling location. So thank you, Jan, Jane, Arlene, and Madeline for being here and sharing the love. Then we'd like to remind everybody that John Wilson will be doing a workshop today, Living Love Workshop at 1:30, room 228. And like I was saying this morning, it's gonna be wonderful because it's John Wilson. Mwah! And this upcoming Saturday, before I do that announcement, those of you who are Ramdas lovers like me, we're coming together, people from the Triangle community, to honor his life. We're gonna be watching his film, Becoming Nobody, and that will be in the Fellowship Hall this Saturday at 2 p.m. There's more information in the bulletin, but if you need more information, you can talk to me. And now to the art exhibit announcement. As you know, we are doing a new exhibition with your art, with mixed media art. So we need you to turn it in by the 22nd, 23rd of March. And then we'll have our opening reception on Wednesday, March 25th, to just show off all this wonderful artwork coming from you. And then, our Unity in the Community folks are invited, and you are invited to be part of this food bank event. It's gonna happen on Saturday, March 21st, but either this Sunday or next Sunday is your time to sign up. This is where we go there and we sort produce, boxing frozen items, and helping out as needed. So this is the sign, and it will be out there. And I guess that continue talking about food. Dr. Mark Edwards will be here. As you know, he's a physician who studied Ayurvedic medicine, and he's gonna be doing a demo, a cooking demo, on Sunday, March 29th at 1 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. There's tickets available. You can either sign up online or go by the lobby and sign up there. I believe that it's gonna be a popular event, so if you're really thinking about it, go ahead and get your ticket to secure your seating there. And now as we culminate our announcements, I'm gonna ask you to join me in a prayer as we start shifting into the flow of quiet and still. So let us pray. Just that, let that melody of the I Believe song bring you back to that place of all possibilities, where we are really led by our inner world and not what the changing world out there might say. We choose God. And the best way to stay centered in that choice is to be faithful to times of quiet, of prayer. So we join in the awareness that we are restored and renewed as we connect to the one presence and one power. I would like to share some words from author Debbie Ford on prayer. Prayer truly delivers us to a holy place. In this higher state of consciousness, we know we are protected, powerful, and strong. We know we have the power to make trauma, heartache, dis-ease, negative emotions, and other day-to-day problems of life disappear. That's right, disappear. When we are one with our Creator, when we are willing to not know, to not understand, to not have it all figured out, to not be in charge, to not have life go the way we think it should go, the miracles can happen. Life can surprise us only as we are willing to be surprised. And what does that take? It takes living a God-centered life. And I repeat that again. It takes a God-centered life, that a life of prayer can ensure for us. We rest in this knowing that there is no place where God's good is not. We rest in this sense of safety, knowing that all is well. For surely that presence always is. And that presence is here and now for you and as you. And so it is.
Surely
God's mighty power and God's grace. There's a holy hush around us. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Many of those standing are holding in their private prayer practice the names in this prayer box. If you'd like to join this prayer ministry, come to a sacred prayer circle training on Saturday morning, March 28th. So now join me in prayer. We shift our attention from the outer world of circumstances and appearances, where we see the world through our outer eyes. And we go within to perceive life through the eyes of God. We declare, how I see is up to me. We choose to perceive life through our inner light, guided by God's divine wisdom and grace. Moment to moment, we consciously choose to see every individual and circumstance through our inner knowing of spiritual truth. We declare that every name in this prayer box has the power to consciously choose to see their circumstances through the consciousness of peace, love, prosperity, and wholeness. With steadfast and unwavering faith, we walk in the light and we see the world through the eyes of God. And so we let it be. Amen.
Let us begin to meditate, adjust the body as necessary, and let the mind commit itself to being at peace. And let's do that by paying attention to our breath for a few moments. Just let the breath be interesting enough to you that the mind can stick with it. And should it wander, which is likely to do, just bring it back. as we practice paying attention to the breath, let's bring the focus to the breath. Imagine, sense, maybe feel that you can breathe inside your own heart, that your heart is the portal of the breath. So we breathe from into the heart. Let us continue that breathing into the heart and also begin to feel the energy of the heart spread out throughout the rest of your being. Let a sense of love and acceptance come over you or in through you. This sense of love be all there is. And if you feel you are being filled with it, then share it with the room and for the world out beyond here, allowing love to be your radiance.
this day.
The choir was amazing this morning, right? Weren't they good? I want to say also, I'm really happy you made it here at right around 11 anyway. I once, probably maybe 15 years ago, I was, it was this day, leap year day. Spring forward day. And I came to church and I went, as I drove up, I went, wow, there are a lot of people here early. And I stayed with my perception of the situation until I opened the sanctuary door and they were just finishing the meditation. And I walked right up on stage and did my talk, but I thought, oh my gosh, I had no idea. Perception is what we're talking about today, and so much of what we experience is really based on what we perceive, really, isn't it? I mean, the filter of our own thoughts limits what can come into our minds. It is as though we don't see the world as it is. We see more like how we are. What we are is what we perceive. So I think it's really a good thing to question your own perception. If you think about it, if it's how I am can be a result of almost a random thing. It doesn't mean it's coming close to being the truth. And this is a problem. It is a problem because so much of our understanding of the world around us is limited by what we have been able to receive in through our senses, which is limited by what we are already thinking and feeling. And therefore, we're in this feedback loop that doesn't let us really know what the world is about. And in some ways, it can be quite torturous if we have a set of filters which see the world as dangerous, frightening, unloving, etc. And so it becomes a great spiritual practice to doubt what you actually see in the world. There is a line that in the Course in Miracles is, I don't know what I'm seeing. It comes out, I translate as, I don't know what I'm looking at. What am I looking at? And I've had that experience lately, over the last few years, of staring out at this and wondering, what am I looking at? What is this? And I think I might be alone in the room with that. But for me, it's become a persistent question, like, what am I looking at? What is this? Which might be the beginning of actually coming to know what it is. One of the things people that I've really admired is Byron Katie. Byron Katie was a woman who was having a miserable life. She hated herself so much she wouldn't sleep in a bed. She was in a halfway house. She said she was sleeping on the floor in a halfway house when a cockroach ran over her foot and something tripped and she began to see the world differently. It turns out there's a guy that comes to the 9 o'clock who's known her from the time she was living in a state of near psychosis into the awakened state that she is now. And I asked, well, how fast did it happen? He said, well, the awakening was quick, but the process of unfolding it took a while. And here's what she came up with as a method of leading us all to this state of awakening. And I just love what she does. And her thing is ask 4 questions and turn it around. So first, judge your neighbor, then ask 4 questions and turn it around. And it goes like this. So y'all should play along with me because it's actually useful. And if you'll do it now, you'll have it more ingrained later if you're not already practicing this. But she would say, you know, find something that irritates you, or maybe something you're angry about, or you were frightened about, or some trauma or something. Find something And since we don't have pen and paper here for you to write it down, get really clear what it is. See if you can draw yourself back into that experience in which you actually remember something that was you were angry about. And from that place, or especially pick somebody and be really detail-oriented, not like, well, you know, I was once angry at the world. That's not close enough to what I'm after. I'm after like an event, something. Fix something and say, I'm angry. I was angry about that, and it should have been somewhere, some other way. What is that? So judge what it should have been like. And in her process, what you would do is write that down. You write it down because our tendency is to go, well, that wasn't exactly what I said. But really, this is exactly what you said if you wrote it down, right? So you judge it, write it down, and now you have it. And it will be your awakening to realize that your judgment is not only about that one particular place, that one particular person, that jerk that did it, but that you hold that attitude everywhere, and you see the world through that attitude, because you don't have just one person you have thought, well, they should tell me the truth and not lie to me. They shouldn't try and fool me, right? You think everybody should be like that, don't you? Or that they don't love me. I'm unlovable. It's not you just don't hold it in one little pocket place. When you clear it up here, you begin to clear it up everywhere. And so being really judgmental, something I'm good at, is a quality that you can use in this situation. So judge somebody, write it down, and then you ask yourself several questions. And the first question is it true that, let's just say, they should not have lied to you? Is that true? And you would say, of course they should not lie to me. And you could probably get all your neighbors to agree with you. Yes, of course they should not. But then if you settle into yourself, into the core of who you are, and you ask the question a little more deeply with more interest, like, can I absolutely know they shouldn't lie to me? And then you come to a question that you can't actually answer yes. A moment of doubt, of possibility that you don't know exactly everything about this, can come in. It's like you've been locked in a dark room and you begin to crack the door open. Because we don't just think, oh, they shouldn't lie to me. What we think is they shouldn't lie to me, and therefore I feel bad about it. I feel bad about being a victim of this. I feel as though someone was trying to take advantage of me, or I think they're a bad person, or et cetera. We have a whole story we add to this, and it adds to it a deepening of our experience, and that deepening is not a happy one, because this is not a happy story we're telling. We're telling a judgmental story, which always brings suffering to us. And so you ask the question, can you absolutely be sure about this? And if you can come to a state of stillness, there's a really good chance you'll say, well, I mean, absolutely. Well, not really. I can't absolutely do that. So now you have your beginning. And through that little crack, you let in more light. When you examine what it cost you to hold that thought, you simply ask the question, what is it? What do I feel like when I believe that thought? What do I feel like when I judge someone that they should not be as they are? What do I feel like? Well, you feel fear, perhaps, or feel anger, or you feel irritation, or you feel revenge. You feel something negative, that's for sure. And you hold that experience as long as you believe the thought. So what does it cost you to have that thought? The feeling, the sensation of fear, anger, and upset. And so how's it working with your judgment? You got somebody you judged. You know, absolutely know they shouldn't be the way they were with you. Can you remember that? Should not be that way? Can you absolutely know that? I'm going to answer for you. No, you don't. Don't know absolutely. So now you need to ask yourself, what does it cost me to have that thought? And if you feel into it, it is not nothing. that which you're feeling and experiencing becomes grounded in you, and it repeats itself because now you have believed it. And this is what it cost you. You not only feel crappy in this situation, you expect in some way to feel that again and to see it out there in the world. And the perception that we have is governed by what we hold in our mind as the possibilities and the experiences we've had in the past. And so we begin to see more chances of having that happen to us again. That's the cost. And then the great beginning, the really deep beginning, is when you say, well, who would I be without that thought? And the peculiar thing about this question, who would you be without that thought? It's like, oh, you mean I don't have to have that thought? You mean it's not real? It's not perfect? I'm not perfectly righteous in my anger and upset? You mean I could have a different thought around this? Is that, you're not saying that, are you? Yes, I'm saying that. Who would you be without that thought? Who would you be without that thought? Now the mind is on another track and you begin to think of paradise, essentially. All good things would be coming your way. Wouldn't you? You would feel lighter, happier. You'd be more generous with your affections. You'd be freer. You'd be less afraid, curious. Lots of things, beautiful things. The beautiful world that we think the world should be. You would be that if you didn't have that thought that the world should not be the way it is. So the idea is essentially what we're doing is we're coming to a state of awareness through this that the world is okay as it is. It's not the world that's a problem. It's my perception of the world that is the problem. And perhaps a real awakening would be not that I fix everything in the world, but that I begin to see the world more clearly without so much judgment. And so the next phase really is to turn it around and say, they shouldn't lie to me. You would say this, I should not lie to myself about the way the world should be. There's a turnaround. I should not lie about the way the world should be. How about that? How about radically different? And they should lie to me. After all, I don't believe them. You could name a lot of things that you could think instead. Most of them would be just as true as your original thought. You do not have to live with the thought that you were presented with, but you begin to clean that up by recognizing that this thought is causing an experience, and the experience is being replicated because now that's how you see the world, and the world can only show you what you're able to see, and so you live inside a prison of your own habit of thought. And to liberate yourself from that is to question your perception, to question your judgment, to question your righteousness. Radical. That's radical. It takes you from the place of victim to wise one. Being at the effect of the world to be an appreciator of the world. From being isolated and afraid to being fearless. So a woman in one of Byron Katie's seminars said to her, yeah, it was, so what if somebody had a gun up to your head? And Byron Katie said, I've had that. And because she's done a ton of work on herself, she didn't really panic. I mean, what? She didn't know what was coming next, even though he said, I'm going to kill you. She looked him in the eye, and in that moment, she saw how afraid and confused he was. And she loved him. And she said, you know, if he had pulled the trigger and shot me, I wouldn't have panicked then either. I would wait to see if it hurt. And who knows if I can really die or not. To live in the question rather than in the certainty allowed her to see, feel love where many of us would have felt fear. And so it's not surprising or that surprising he didn't pull the trigger. Obviously, she was telling the story. But she had this ability to be fresh in the moment and not afraid, to see this person as a human being and not as a threat. Now, wouldn't that be a beautiful thing for each of us, to be able to walk through life as clear in our perception that someone could put a gun up against us and say, I'm going to kill you, and we don't panic, and all we feel is love. Now that's a paradise. That would mean nothing can get you. That would mean that you are not a victim of the world you see, you are the appreciator of the world you see. And all the display of enemies that we have held as a practice. At 9 o'clock I said, you know, who's got an enemy? And of course no one raised their hand because we're unity people. And I said, well, what about the other political party? And they all laughed at that moment because we have chosen in our own fashion to see other in so many people now. We have built a sense of separation from so many people that they are not like us. How is that true? Can you absolutely know that is true? And what does it cost you to have that thought? What does it cost you to believe that half of this whole country is crazy? Who would you be without the thought? How would you interact at a party or at your family gatherings if you didn't think there was something wrong with them? I don't know, I'm hoping to go to a party where they don't think that about me, because I know. No, don't you? We often return the favor, we once felt it, and then we return the favor in spades. Oh, you don't think I'm okay? Well, I not got something for you. I don't think you're okay either, right? Let's come to our senses. Let's come to our senses, really, and see our senses for what they are. Filters that let in only what we can hear and don't let in what we don't hear. And if we feel as though we're a victim in this world, then let us look again. Is that true? Or are we doing it to ourselves? I was watching a video of Byron Katie. She was with guys in prison, a bunch of guys in prison. They were there because they were addicts of some sort. And this was supposed to be a rehabilitation training. And that was really interesting that most of those guys zipped right through it and kind of got to the core of this right away. But there was one guy that she started talking to, and he could not get off it. Do you know what I mean? It was his father's fault or his stepfather's fault or somebody's fault that he was a drug addict. He was really sure that was the case, and he would not get off it. You absolutely have ruined my world. You have made me the person I am. I'm the victim here. And I did see something I'd never seen in her before. She just kind of let the guy have it and let him sit with that because he just wasn't willing to look. You know? You ever been like that? You're so right. It might be killing you, but you're so right, you're gonna make the other person wrong, no matter what, right? Or am I wrong? Years ago, I was doing a meditation retreat. This was a 10-day meditation retreat, and I had been through a tough time in my life. It seemed like everything I wanted, I had been able to blow up and destroy. And there was somebody that was not even all that important, but I was sitting in meditation, and it was the kind of meditation where you, about day three, your body hurts anyway because you're sitting 10 hours a day, and it just, the back. And you're sitting on the floor, cross-legged, it was awful. And, you know, you go to this thing thinking, oh, meditation, I've heard so many great stories, I'll be in an enlightened state by the time I leave here. Nah, about day three, all you can think is, damn. But I noticed a very peculiar thing happened to me that I started an argument in my mind, somebody who wasn't there, wasn't within 1,000 miles of me. I started to have an argument in my mind with somebody. And I had this argument, and I could feel a knife, the equivalent of a knife penetrating right about here in my chest. And it, with every sentence in that argument, it was just being pushed in deeper and deeper. And I remember saying to myself, yeah, I know that's causing it, but I'm going to have this argument. Right? Sometimes we do that. But when we want to wake up, when it's been painful enough, long enough, maybe it would be a good time just to say, is that true? Is my perception true? Is it real? Can I absolutely, is there any chance here I could be off just a little bit maybe? And then begin to go through those steps of what does it cost me to keep holding on to this idea? How long have I been hurting and how many ways have I been hurting around this, and just to feel it. And when we get to that point, we're getting pretty ready to change. Because then the next thing is say, who would you be without it? Who could I be if I didn't have this thought? And that is when the paradigm of paradise comes about. Liberation, freedom, love, happiness, kindness, etc. Peace. Without the thought. Who would I be without that thought? And then the question is, how can you reverse the way you've been thinking? And in reversing the thinking, you know, instead of saying, they shouldn't have done that, you go, I shouldn't be judging them about that. Bring it back to yourself. I shouldn't lie to myself. I shouldn't be afraid. I shouldn't claim that someone else has done it to me as I am attacking them with my thoughts, etc. We just find a turnaround when it looks like we have now taken ownership of this situation. This is where the power comes back to us. And our fear can go down. Our habit of seeing enemies and others can go down. And we can be at home in this world again. I think this is a stretch, what I'm going to say right now. But you know, this whole thing around the coronavirus, and I have a case of corona that I got really cheap, if anybody anybody would like. But this whole thing about a coronavirus, what is it causing us to do? It's giving us a chance to look at the world quite differently, isn't it? Because there's a generalized concern, I'll say, around the transmission of this, then people have been forced to isolate, in China in particular, they've been isolated from each other in a way, even a more exaggerated way than ever before that I've ever heard of, where they quarantine a city. And there's quarantines here and there all over the place. And there's we're not hugging and kissing and all that here. And I remember a Sicilian where they have a bit of the outbreak of the coronavirus and they're still hugging and kissing. He says, hey, we're Sicilian. What do you mean? But we're being asked to pull back from our contact with other people in very conscious ways. So that's one thing that's happening, a deepening of the sense of separation. But on the other hand, we could see it this way, that this whole coronavirus is spreading across the world at such a rapid rate that pretty soon we'll all be in it together, right? And the same problem that is causing us not to touch so much each other. It is also causing us to realize we are all so closely connected, we can't even get through life without being in contact, not only with the person here in the seat next to you, but ultimately in somebody in China. We're just in this big world together. There's no like other. Everybody's susceptible to it. Nobody's like a hero. And you know, that's how I feel about my life all the time. I could never be sick. I had a stroke here on the pew, but aside from that, that feeling of isolation is only one option. We could also look at this through the lens of we're just being proven the whole world's in bed with us in a certain sense. They're all very, very close. So you can decide which thought you want to lead with, which one you want to deepen. Judge your neighbor, write it down, ask four questions and turn it around. That's a path to enlightenment. Let us pray. The deepest wounds are the wounds that we give ourselves when we say somehow we're unworthy, unlovable. Somebody has done something to us that keeps us from ever appreciating ourselves again. Can that be true? Is that true? Is that true? You're unlovable. Is that true? In any part of you, is that true? Yeah. And when you hold that thought, what do you feel? What's it like? That somehow you're inadequate and not a child of God. Somehow you're less than whole, less than perfect, less than beautiful, less than precious. What is it like to feel that? To let that thought run rampant? Who would you be without that thought? How would you feel about yourself? How would you act in the world? Would you smile more? Would you love more graciously? Would you be willing to risk being the first to say, I'm sorry, would you be different? If you were the child of God, that the saints and sages have always said you were, and not the thought that there's something wrong with you, who would you be? How would you act? Could it not be that that is more true than the statement we used to say about ourselves? Could it be that we are lovable, capable, innocent? Beautiful. Let it be so. Let it be so. Amen. I appreciate y'all being here. I realize that I never try to learn something as much as I do on Saturday night and Sunday morning. And so without your presence here, I probably would be the Philistine that I have always thought I was all the time. But occasionally I get curious because I need to say something on Sunday. So thank you. I appreciate that. We have a discussion after this service, a Q&A at a little bit after, probably might start a little earlier than 11:35 because I have a few things later to do. So maybe around 12:25, excuse me, we'll meet upstairs in the big room upstairs. And we also have a panel discussion coming on the 26th, which I hope you'll consider doing. We're going to have a little bit of food there. It's going to be kind of like a salon with these three experts talking to us. All of them have been teaching the Course in Miracles for at least 10 years. It's an amazing opportunity for us. They've been students of this long enough that they have insights that would be helpful for us. And I just want to say we're also going to take up the offering differently here. And we're not going to hold hands at the peace song. It's a drag, isn't it? I'm used to this full body contact when I come in here, right? And we're only going to do this long enough that people stop being afraid. We're doing this not because we're afraid it's here. We're doing it so that people won't be focusing on a virus, but instead will be focusing on their deeper self, on their own awakening, rather than on a small little thing that might get in the way. So we take getting that out of the way as best we can. We're just going to be present. And if we can use this time to be really deeply present with each other, perhaps in a way that we used to just jump over by a hug and an adios, we might actually deepen in our conversation somehow. Let's see if we can find a way to use this inconvenience to become even more of a family. So, with that in mind, we're not going to take up an offering. You will just leave baskets outside. But we are going to bless it, and you know, one thing we do have are some really cool ways of paying by credit card. You can also, during this time period, if you don't want to touch anybody for any reason at all, you could text the money to us. You don't even have to reach in and touch that ugly green paper. No, you could just be totally antiseptic. Or you can swipe your card, or lots of things, or you can go on a consistent giving. Now, if they shut us down, which I don't expect they will, we're going to need some consistent giving. People who automatically give through their credit cards or through their bank accounts. And I hope you'll consider that. It would be a wise move for you to sign up now while you're thinking about it. But do consider that as a possibility. Part of the things, as you know, our bills never go away, right? We still have a mortgage, we still have lights, we have, you know, we have staff, we have lots of things to pay for. So I didn't plan on talking so much about this, but since I'm on a roll, consider this idea of automatic giving. It's a brilliant way to do it. You don't even have to bring your wallet, right? It's just done. And I just signed up for that on PBS, so why don't you do it here? Okay, let's bless our offering. Together. Divine love as me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you.
Thank you. afternoon, everybody. I'm Lauren, and I wanted to announce that our regional representative for the Southeast YOU, Gabe Lopez, one of our seniors, he just received an announcement that he is first chair for saxophone in all of North Carolina. And we're really proud, and we wanted to congratulate him and share the amazing news that we just received. So thank you so much.
Yay. Okay, let's stand, everybody. We're going to stand. We're going to give love here. Ready? From our hearts to your tender hearts, we say these words together. You are love, special, and important, just the way you are. Now let's not join hands and sing the next song. The light of God surrounds us.
I am the light of God.
The love of God enfolds us.
I am the love of God.
The power of God protects us.
I am the power of God.
The presence of God watches over us.
I am the presence of God.
Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. See you next week.